We're ready for next talk now, so I'm very happy to introduce Dan here, who's going to be telling you all about his container ship holiday. And if anyone's right at the front, you might want to sit a little bit back to see the screens, to see the pictures clearly. So, yeah, go ahead, Dan. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello, I'm Dan, and this is the Maersk Salita. It's a 320-meter-long container ship carrying about 8,000 20-foot equivalent units of cargo, and it's where I spent my summer holidays. I should warn you in advance two things. This is not a talk about Linux container virtualization or Docker. It is about actual ships and actual containers. And secondly, this is a slideshow of my holiday. Like, this is just pictures of me posing in front of things. There's no, like, educational content. It's the most self-indulgent thing I've ever done. And if you do want to see anything, you'll need to look at the screens rather than the projector. There's some dark images, I'm afraid. So we set off for a week's voyage, traveling from Busan in South Korea to Hong Kong, stopping in Yangshan in Shanghai, Ningbo, and Kaohsiung in Taiwan. This trip was arranged by Unknown Fields, a part of the Architecture Association School, as an expedition for designers and architects to explore supply chains, run by Liam Young, Kate Davies, and Zhang Wang. So the plan is to explore the supply chain going backwards, starting from the ship, and then when we reach land in China, go to visit factories, mines, refineries, wholesalers, to see where things like mobile phones come from. But first we had to get there. It turns out getting on a container ship takes a bit of paperwork. About 3 weeks before the voyage, we got initial contact from Maersk saying which ship we're going to be on, probably, because the schedules changed quite last minute, with instructions. Within a week, we had to get a criminal background check, a medical examination, various vaccinations like yellow fever. The NHS look at you in a slightly bemused manner when you turn up and say, I need this Danish medical examination done, please. It's not a standard procedure. You have to kind of find a doctor you can pay privately who will then go through the list of quite strange things that they don't normally do, including reflex tests. The doctor I went to hadn't done a reflex test in years. I had to go searching the entire GP for a hammer to hit my knee to go, yes, you have a reflex. And so we flew to Busan, and just about a day before we got aboard the ship, the instructions from Maersk arrived. The first point seems quite sensible. It's a dangerous environment. Take care. About the same time I received this email, I saw a tweet from Maersk Line celebrating the fact that they had no fatalities in 2013, and this was quite an unusual occurrence. But the rest of the instructions carry on quite nicely. We're allowed to go anywhere, photograph anything, talk to anyone, do pretty much anything we want, so long as it's not dangerous. It's very friendly and welcoming. It's not what we were expecting from what's quite a secretive, protective industry that likes to stay out of the public spotlight. And so we fly to Busan, and from the airport, a port agent collects you. The port agent handles every interface between the ship and the port. That includes picking up crew and bringing you aboard. So he picks you up from the airport, drives you through an hour of kind of industrial outskirts of the city. We pass through the old port of Busan, which had just been replaced by the new port of Busan, which is about an hour further out of the city. They take you to an anonymous industrial building with fluorescent lighting and ceiling tiles. It's exactly the same as any office building you've ever been. And here that you go for immigration and a number of other things. It's slightly unlike normal airport immigration, where you sit on a bench, the port agent takes your paperwork and passport to the counter for you, and the immigration agent just kind of leans over and goes, yeah, that's you. And then you go to security, where there's x-ray machines and metal detectors, all the usual thing, and they kind of wave you through without actually checking anything, because who's going to sneak into a port, it turns out. Well, it turns out the executives of the Korean ferry companies responsible for the disaster a few months ago did escape the country through traveling as passengers on container ships, which meant the Korea no longer allowed passengers on a container ship, so technically we were crew. Then take you through the port, which is a long drive through just stacks and stacks of containers, just endless containers. Quite a lot of containers. Several miles of containers. Until eventually, after weaving through all these lorries carrying cargo, you arrive at your ship, and you get a glimpse of it, and you can weave through between the cranes and the cargo until you get alongside. It's quite hard to convey how massive these ships are. When you stood alongside it, it's just a flat wall several stories high of just solid blue. Well, vaguely solid blue. It's quite patchy. They've kind of had to repaint it quite a bit and not entirely uniformly. So to get aboard, you wander up your gangway, and the port agent hands you over to the chief officer, who gives you an introduction, paperwork, and they take away your passport. From then onwards, you belong to the ship. The ship handles all immigration. You can't leave until the ship decides you're leaving, and they handle the departure for you and give your passport back. And then they take you to see the captain. This is our captain, Captain Argent. He's from Liverpool, and he's quite excited to see us. There's a bunch of Brits coming aboard. And so he kind of greets us and says, "Do you know why I'm so excited this week?" And we went, "Because you've got passengers. It's going to be a change of scene." And he goes, "No, I'm retiring when we get to Hong Kong." This was his last ever voyage. And so he had an entire lifetime worth of stories to tell us, which was brilliant. And he was also completely relaxed and kind of checked out, and so willing to let us get away with a lot of things. Although the first thing he introduced us to was the fact that we were heading into a typhoon. Yeah, more about that later. So as we're chatting, he's kind of telling us about the ship, and we're asking questions, and his wife Helen, because you're allowed to bring your family on board, so him and his wife Helen live on board the ship, kind of interrupts and goes, "Come on, they just want to see the bridge. Give me the keys, I'll take them up." So we head up top and see the bridge, and it's lovely. You have a marvellous view from the bridge. When you walk in, you're kind of deafened by alarms, because in port, the bridge is just locked and kept unattended, so any alarms that go off aren't cancelled. And this is the view when you walk in. It's just containers swinging by as if it's a normal thing, which to them it is. As we were coming aboard, we saw another Maersk ship leave alongside us, the Kinloss. On the Unknown Fields expedition, there were 18 of us. The most passengers you can carry on a cargo ship is 12. Any more than that, you need to carry a doctor as well. So they split us between six different ships. So we got to see two of our colleagues leaving on a different ship and wave across at them and shout across on the radio, which is quite nice. But we weren't going to leave until the evening. They'd only just arrived and were loading cargo on. So we got taken and given our cabins. There were four of us as passengers on this ship, which is quite abnormal amongst a Maersk ship, because they don't carry passengers normally. It's a liability. Their priority is the cargo. A passenger is just an extra hindrance. They don't bring enough revenue in to be worthwhile. And if, say, for example, you fell ill and they had to divert to get you to safety, that would delay the cargo and cost them several million. So we were kind of put in whichever spare cabins they had going. I was given the pilot's room on E deck. The rest of the group were given cabins on C deck. It turns out I had the smallest cabin of the group, which wasn't too bad because it's bigger than my flat in London. It's got a single bed, a desk, an armchair, sofa, coffee table, an ensuite bathroom, and a marvelous view of the ocean. Well, I mean, if you kind of look to the side, you can see more containers. My colleagues were in bigger cabins. Liam got the master steward's cabin, which has like a separate bedroom, living room, separate rooms. It's on the side of the ship, so it has a nice view without any containers. The cabin's also equipped with handy things like a manual for the ship, in case you should need to use it. Hopefully not. And so we went through our familiarization training, which includes like health and safety stuff, signing off lots of paperwork, list of rules, things you have to know, instructions on how to launch the lifeboats. And one of the things you have to sign is that you've searched your room for any hidden compartments that may contain contraband. And I searched my room, and this was in the cupboard. And so I asked my fellow passengers, and they too found this in their cupboard. And we were like, "Is this a test? Are they checking that we've done the paperwork properly?" So we kind of sheepishly went, "What's this?" And they went, "Washing powder. It's for doing your laundry." Most of the ship is dedicated to cargo. There's only one bit that isn't, which is the accommodation block. The accommodation block is about two-thirds of the way back of the ship, and it contains, on the very top, the bridge for navigating the ship, also called the nav deck, bedrooms where everyone stays. It's got some communal spaces, like just like a kind of shared common room. It's got a video library in case you want to watch some films. It has a swimming pool, dining rooms, laundry, gin, just all the things you want when you're stuck at sea for up to 9 months at a time. It's also got all the mod cons. It's got Wi-Fi. And we were chatting to the captain, he said one of the main reasons people join Maersk is you have free Wi-Fi. It's so you can keep in touch with your family, whereas on most ships you can't, apart from phone calls. And so people are willing to work for a lower wage just for the fact that they have Wi-Fi aboard. Well, when I say they have Wi-Fi aboard, they've got these, they're locked into a contract with a certain enterprise provider which don't produce the greatest Wi-Fi access points, so you have to kind of huddle in specific spots in the corridor to get the best signal. It's got a satellite backhaul, which is okay-ish, but it's also got a limit on the amount of data that can be used every day, which means you have curfew hours for when the Wi-Fi is switched on. Also on board you have a dining room and kitchen. All the meals are cooked for you. There's kind of three dining times per day, 7 a.m. breakfast, midday lunch, 5 p.m. dinner. And those are the only times you have food, so you have to be there or you go hungry. And everything on board is branded. You eat off Maersk branded plates, for example. Even your midnight snack of bread with processed cheese comes on a Maersk branded plate. The food waste is the only thing they're allowed to throw overboard as waste when they're a certain distance from land. All material now has to be kept and taken to shore and disposed of and recycled. Whereas in the past, this hasn't been the case. And when you're sailing at sea, you quickly see that there's plastic everywhere. It's just constant plastic bottles and carrier bags floating past no matter where you are. The ship's run by a Danish company, so you have random Danish things aboard, like the computer keyboards are a Danish layout. Also in the accommodation block on A deck towards the bottom is the control, the ship's control room, which is mainly a meeting room, but it's also got this, which is the ballast control panel. Each of these buttons handles a different pump, and each diagram shows a different ballast measurement from a different ballast tank. It's also where you keep things like the firefighting equipment and your hazmat suits. On the outside of the accommodation block, you've got these bridge wings so that you can kind of see the view or walk up and down, which has my favorite feature of the ship, the abandoned chair. One of the first officers aboard the ship bought a chair for his room, and one day he put it outside to enjoy the sunshine. He forgot it outside for a few days. It turns out the diesel exhaust from the funnel and the humid weather makes chairs rot and go bad quite quickly, so he just left it there. And it's been abandoned there ever since. Occasionally they repaint it. It wasn't originally blue, but the only paint they have is Maersk blue, so it's now blue. As part of the familiarization, you have your full training and your PPE equipment. You have to, you get your overalls, your hard hat, your safety boots, your gloves. We got a pretty thorough tour of the ship. When they said go everywhere and see everything, we took it quite seriously. We started the Monkey Island, it's the very top of the ship. It's the highest point with the best view. But you can't really hang out there because it's where all the radio equipment is. And there's lovely old painted circles on the floor saying, if you're within this circle, you're being exposed to radiation. It's also got the foghorn, so you don't really want to be up there when that gets used. I like to think of this as the swimming pool. You've also got all the usual anti-piracy measures. These are the anti-piracy locks. They kind of just bolt the door closed. That's pretty much it in terms of anti-piracy measures, just door locks and a safe place to hide. Alongside the ship, you've got a walkway that can take you the full length of the ship underneath the cargo. And you can get to the very front and lean over the edge and look down at the bulb of the bow. I've been told if you do the Titanic thing, you will be taken off the ship. It's surprisingly calm. The ships travel incredibly slowly. The most important thing in them is fuel efficiency. So you're crawling along at like kind of 10 knots most of the time, and the ocean when there isn't a storm, can be quite flat. It's just gliding along glass slowly. Also at the front of the ship is the dangerous cargo. These are the most volatile items kept away from the rest of the cargo on the accommodation block. I believe we were carrying acid and something flammable, I can't quite remember. It's surprising how much of a beating the containers take. They're kind of quite worn and full of dents, some of them. So whilst we were taking this tour, it turns out the ship next to us was leaving. This is the Caroline, a C-class. We were the Sleeter, an S-class. It turns out they're not alphabetically organized, so I don't know if the C is bigger or smaller than us. To leave, you get towed out by a tug, and then the Caroline got replaced by the Ever, I believe. It's an E-class. Until a few months ago, this was the largest ship in the world. It's quite large. It kind of dwarfs our ship alongside it. But we were getting towards the end of the day. It was sunset, and it was pretty much time for us to leave. This is our first experience of leaving port. Tugs come alongside and drag you away from the port itself. It's surprising how quickly you move. Also on board is a pilot. The pilot is responsible for navigating you out of the port and kind of giving advice to the captain. It's pilot's advice, captain's orders, so that's the kind of priority. So we kind of glided out into the darkness. And there's not really much to see once you leave port, with this kind of glassy, still, calm port. And as soon as you kind of turn around and get spun out, there's just nothing but dark ocean, apart from a few small islands you have to dodge in the middle of the harbour, which I've been told are currently being removed, and they're just removing the islands. And the port is still being built. Next to the port is a mountain that they're currently demolishing. Just gone, the whole mountain. Next day was our first full day at sea. I got up foolishly at about 4:30 a.m. to watch the sunrise because I thought, how often do I have a chance to watch the sunrise over the East China Sea on a container ship? It turns out 7 times. So the whole time you're traveling in shipping lanes, passing other ships. It being our first day, we had the abandoned ship drill. Helen, the captain's wife, was quite unhappy about this. She thought she'd done her last ever lifeboat drill, and then we turned up, and once a certain percentage of the crew changes in a port, you have to redo the drill. She wasn't best pleased with us. So you have plans and drills every week for different scenarios, firefighting. This time we were just doing the lifeboat drill. This is one of the lifeboats. There's 2 main lifeboats. They're pretty much full boats. They've got engines. They've got enough space for about 20 people. You can happily go out and sail around in these. You also have little backup ones, ones that automatically float off the ship sinks, barrel ones that you throw over and automatically inflate. But it's best not to use those if you can. In fact, it's best to stay on the ship unless you really, really have to leave. The ship is your best lifeboat. And so in the abandoned ship, each person has a role. There's a list on the wall saying which lifeboat you've been assigned to out of the two and what your instructions are. We were lucky, we just had assist as required, which is basically stand at the back being a bit useless. Whereas other people have to do things like fetch the search and rescue transponders or radio the distress call and that kind of thing. You're given a number and you literally just stand on the number next to the lifeboat. First, you have to run to your room, put on your safety boots, your overalls, your life jacket, get your immersion suit so that you can last at sea. It turns out it's quite difficult to start the engine on one of these lifeboats. We had to hand crank start it to prove we could, and I'm not strong enough. So best not to sink with me aboard. So we sailed for a complete day out at sea, just sailing, doing nothing. It was kind of our only long haul on this trip, heading to a port. We left Busan in the evening on the Sunday, and we were due to arrive at Shanghai 8 a.m. on the Tuesday. So Monday was a complete day's sailing. And we kind of got up early, excited on the Tuesday to see us go into port. And plans had changed. The port was quite busy. We had to wait till the evening. So instead, we got to see them anchor the ship. This is the ship's anchor. It's got a nice, hefty deadbolt on top to hold it in so it doesn't drop accidentally. You undo the bolt, and it has 2 ways of lowering itself. The first way is a slow hydraulic lowering. You'll see there's a little red buckle somewhere near the top of the chain. the way you keep track of how much chain you've put out is with these little coloured buckles. You just count them as they go past. Under hydraulic lowering, it gives you a computer readout how many metres you've dropped. But when you do free fall, when you let the anchor drop free fall, you don't have a way of measuring how much chain you've put out. So you let down a little bit so the anchor is pretty much at the water, and then you slow the ship down, you pick your parking spot carefully, you point it into the current, and you stop dead still. And then you let the anchor drop. And I hadn't considered how violent a process that is. If I had audio for this, you'd be deafened by how loud it is. It kind of just made me jump and startle. All the dust coming off it is the mud from the seafloor from the previous time it's been used. And the whole time there's someone stood next to it just shouting out how many chains they've seen go past or whether they want to stop, because each one of the little buckles has an engraved number on it, which is like, we've dropped 7 of them. I can't remember the exact distance. I think each one was about 50 metres. We were dropping about 500 metres of chain, I believe. It was so violent, it just spun my camera around off its tripod. And then you're anchored. You've got an anchor down, you're there, you're nice and still, you can stay there for the whole day. The final maneuver you do is you reverse slightly to pull on the chain, and then you just sit there. You switch the engine off, and you do nothing. And you just drift around in the current, swinging around your anchor. After a few hours, we'd swung about a quarter of the way around the anchor. And it's just a relaxing day. You sit in the sun, read a book, watch the other ships narrowly swerve past you. This is the Kinloss again. Turns out on the same course as us, just one port ahead. So we got to see the Kinloss quite a lot. End of the day, coming up to sunset, time to leave. You just lift the anchor up. By the time we'd gone to leave, we'd spun around 3/4 of the way, pivoting around the anchor point in the changes of current and tide. And so we were off into the sunset, heading towards our first port of call, Yangshan. Yangshan is located 30 kilometres off the coast of Shanghai. It's built on entirely reclaimed land. It's an artificial island they've built, and it's connected to the land by a 30 kilometre long bridge, which can only be accessed if you're a lorry delivering containers, essentially. It's not open to the public. But it's newly been built a few years ago, so it's quite easy to navigate into, and it's been custom built for large container ships. But just before you get there, you take aboard your pilot. This is a tug dropping off the pilot. The pilot just stands on the front and jumps aboard. I'll show you a better photo. This is from Kaohsiung. This is the pilot balancing on the front of the boat. This is the pilot jumping onto the ladder. This is the pilot climbing up the ladder. The ladder is literally just wood and string. And when you get about a third of the way up, you can jump across then onto the gangway, which takes you the rest of the way up. The pilot's responsible for navigating you in, and the first thing the pilot does when they get on board is take out their laptop. There's a special socket on the ship called the AIS socket. It's just for the pilot to plug in and see the readouts of which ships are near and where they are. And they kind of bring their own computer to do this. In Yangshan, they were just Windows XP laptops. We had one port where the pilot brought an iPad and a special Wi-Fi bridge to plug in so he could wander around whilst he was navigating. It's quite common, becoming less common now, that a pilot will ask you for a gift of some sort to help make the process smoother. The ship carries a supply of cigarettes just for easing its passage around the world. And so recently they've been trying to crack down on this. They've actually started explicitly calling it bribery. You have lovely diagrams and training and flowcharts of what to do if someone attempts to request a bribe, including, like, go ask their boss. There's different ways of doing it in different ports. In some Indian ports, the pilot will ask for a compliment, to which our captain likes to reply, "Your hair looks nice today." So after weaving in, we get to Yangshan. Yangshan is massive. The captain said it was 5 nautical miles long. Wikipedia said it was 20 kilometres long, the quay. We were on the furthest berth along, so we get this lovely nighttime drift along the whole length of the port, got to see the view. And whilst we're doing this, the 3 tugs come alongside. To take us into port, there are 3 different tugs that push and pull at the ship. Usually for us, we had 3 at the rear and 1 at the front. At the front, we have a bow thruster that lets the ship move sideways, but at the back we don't have a thruster, so you need the tugs to push and pull you to get you alongside. Now, these things are massive. It's just quite difficult to convey scale on this because the people are so small they don't come out on this screen. And once you're getting close to the key wall, the officer on watch and the pilot leaves the bridge. They leave all the high-tech controls. They walk out onto the bridge wings and open up the secondary controls on the outside. And the way they check how close they are isn't through some kind of clever sonar system. It's through leaning over the edge and taking a look. It's an incredibly high-tech process. This thing at the front, I don't know its proper name, but it's just nicknamed the barbecue. So once you're alongside, you have to moor. There's people on the port who help moor you. This is the next day when another ship pulled in alongside us. And these guys were brilliant. They were like some kind of slapstick comedy routine. They were just tripping over each other, laughing, stopping to wave for the camera. They were having a whale of a time. But what they're doing is pulling in the mooring lines of the ship, attaching them to a forklift, which then pulls the mooring lines on so they can tie the ship on. And the whole time the ship's being pinned by a tug so that it doesn't drift off whilst they're doing this. And so this is Yangshan. It's just, the port itself is just an endless sea of containers. These are all containers that are ready to be loaded onto a ship, have just been offloaded, or are waiting to be transferred between ships. And to shuffle them around, you have gantry cranes that pick them up off the stacks. Here in Yangshan, it's a newly built port, so these gantry cranes are automated. They use like a mixture of dead reckoning, LiDAR, computer vision to know where the containers are along the stack, pick them up, and then line it up with the lorry that's parked underneath to take the container. And if there's a problem where it can't line it up by itself, it hands over to an operator in the port's control room who's operating like 10, 20 of them at a time, a kind of remote tech support kind of situation. And these things just roll back and forth. If there's one rolling, it has right of way. You're not meant to walk or drive in front of it. And they drop them onto lorries, the lorries shuttle them to the ship. But this technique varies between ports. In Kaohsiung, they have mobile gantry cranes. These load onto the stacks and remove from the stacks, as well as driving them to the ship. So they just kind of carry the container nestled beneath and drop it down. The driver sitting sideways, so he can drive both ways without having to turn around. To bring them onto the ship, you have cranes, obviously. Quite massive cranes. Like, we're on this ship, which is from the waterline, probably like 7-10 stories tall, and these cranes just dwarf you. These wheels are probably the height of the person, and they move at quite a quick pace when they decide to roll along the quay. So I was standing on the quay in there's a little dedicated painted bit where pedestrians are allowed to stand, where you're supposedly safe from the cranes and lorries, and this thing just started rolling over me. And you have to kind of resist your urge to run away, because the safe spot is between the crane, not alongside the crane. As they roll along, they spool up or roll out the power cable. There's just this big, heavy-duty power line next to the wheels of the crane that carry the main electricity to it. They pick up boxes. They swing boxes across. They put boxes on ship. But how do the boxes stay on the ship? Well, the first thing that gets offloaded when you get to a port, and the last thing that gets loaded back on, is this. It's a pallet of twist locks. The twist locks are what hold the containers together and hold them onto the ship. This is one. I've heard someone describe them as mini elephants. I don't quite see the resemblance myself. And they're really heavy-duty pieces of equipment. They're really heavy as well. I've been told if you annoy someone on a ship, you might find a few in your suitcase when you go to the airport and find you've gone over the allowance just to get their revenge on you. I've even heard stories of some ports where suddenly you don't have enough of your twist locks left, but conveniently there's someone there to sell you them back. And they're really quite a simple mechanism. This is an open twist lock. You pull the cord, and that turns it and clips the container on. And that's enough to hold two containers together. The containers can tip and tilt, and they'll still be attached to each other. The other mechanism for attaching the bottom few containers is lashings, which are these
diagonal bars that get attached. But to undo and attach these twist locks, someone has to go up there. So for that, you have the stevedores. When you come into the port, they work for the port, they come aboard, and they go do this. This is the stevedores at Busan being craned alongside the containers to pull on these cords. In Shanghai, however, the stevedore sits on top of the crane, steps out from the crane, lowers his stick over the edge, and pulls on all these little cords. And he's literally going along just before the crane, unlashing each of the containers just in time. It's just an insane job, and I don't think I'd have the stomach to do it. He's got a safety harness that he clips onto the container as he walks along. But the twist locks are still attached to the container, they're just undone. So when the container gets lowered down by the crane, there's individuals alongside the container who have to manually remove the twist locks and chuck them back in the basket. And when you pick them up, they have to reattach them before it goes back on. So these are people just running around attaching twist locks. And this chap has a little electronic device which tells him which containers are meant to go on the ship and where they're meant to go. The process for knowing where they go varies between ports. Some ports just have a clipboard and a piece of paper. And for loading and discharging, you have these discharge forms. They're generated by a piece of software called Loadstar. So this is all the containers that are meant to be removed when we get to Shanghai. It's kind of a semi-automated process. A person has to sit there and babysit it and make sure it loads things correctly. You're juggling all sorts of factors when you're loading. You want to keep your dangerous cargo to the front. You want to keep your refrigerated cargo where there's power. Delicate cargo in the hold. You want to make sure that cargo doesn't sit on top of cargo for a different port so that it blocks it when you get there. And so the way they handle it is usually they stack cargo per port vertically on top of each other. So I believe purple is Hong Kong and blue is Yantian. So whichever one you go to first, you don't have to remove one to get rid of the other. So you just have these charts. With the containers, you don't know what's in the containers on the ship. The crew don't get to find out. The whole point of containerization is to make it the same and anonymous, which helps reduce pilfering. The two things you do get to know about are the refrigerated cargo and the dangerous cargo. So this is the list of our dangerous cargo. It's got things like fish meal, which I didn't know fish meal was a dangerous good. Airbag inflators, helium, acid, environmentally hazardous substance. The descriptions are kind of quite vague normally, but they just give you a category. You've also got your refrigerated, which have to be plugged into power, kept at a specific temperature, and you have to monitor them throughout the journey. So most of the cargo sits in the hold below deck. And it's got these kind of walkways between the containers, so you can go do the lashings and check on things. And it means you can stand next to them and film them when they're being dropped in and picked out. This container being removed is an odd one. It's not a standard box, it's a flat pallet. It turns out not everything fits in a standard cargo container, so they have quite a variety of different shapes. So this is a flat pallet. You put kind of industrial equipment that's too big for a normal container on top of it. But to seal the stuff that goes beneath deck into in the hold, you have the hatch. It's just a large metal hatch that gets lifted up and lowered down by the same cranes that pick the containers. And it makes this wonderful booming sound, which I can only describe as the bit where they seal the T-Rex into the hold in The Lost World. You can go into the hold. There are walkways. Normally they don't have to go down there. It's quite deep and it's quite poorly lit. Only the stairwell bits are lit. So we took the go everywhere, see everything quite seriously. You see quite a lot of odd-shaped cargo that isn't a container. These are kind of really short pallets. Porter cabins. Anyway, it was time to leave Yangshan. We took aboard our pilot, opened up the barbecue, and set sail. We were heading out into the remains of the edge of the typhoon that was passing earlier. I thought, with this 5-kilometer-long quay, and we were at the end of it, I would stick a camera on the side, photograph the whole thing, and stitch it together to make a 5-nautical-mile-long panorama. What I hadn't realized was, for my camera, I'd bought a very cheap mount off eBay.
and the wind of the typhoon was quite strong. So as the tugs pull us out and spin us 180 degrees, something happened. It kind of buckled under the wind, and I ended up with a long time-lapse video of the ship's swimming pool. As we were leaving, we passed the Skagen, another ship carrying some of our colleagues. This time we managed to radio across and have a chat. Our captain's very laid back and never corrected us on any terminology. But when we were on the radio to the other ship, Liam asked, "How's your boat?" And instantly the captain went, "It's a ship, not a boat." I looked up the definition afterwards of the difference between a ship and a boat, and the definition is, if you call a ship a boat, the captain will be offended. So this is us passing the Skagen. The Skagen is the same as our ship, but modified with a taller bridge so they can stack more things on it. We went out into the typhoon, and luckily it mostly dissipated. It was just a bit of a swell. In your cabin, you haven't really got point of reference to the horizon, so around the ships you have little things to show you how much you're listing. As I was drifting off to sleep, I put my phone accelerometer down. It was going about 6 degrees, which is more than I enjoy. Anyway, we were lucky we were just going around the corner to Ningbo. It's a port also outside Shanghai. The two ports are very near each other. So we pulled in there, and it's pretty much the same setup, same types of cranes, same type of working method. Not really much to say about it, apart from we had a very nice pilot guide us out. He was very chatty. He was very keen to point out the sights of Ningbo. So this is the world's tallest electricity pylon at Ningbo. It's taller than the Eiffel Tower. He was very proud of it. So yeah, pilot took us out, pilot jumped off the boat, pilot left. And as we were leaving, we were passing lots and lots of anchored ships. These were mainly crude carriers, which were couldn't handle the typhoon's swell. A crude carrier hasn't got a very good GM. It's very difficult to maneuver, and it's liable to capsize, much easier than our ship. Theoretically, our ship could go to about 70 degrees before it reached the point of vanishing stability, which is my new band name. Anyway, you pilot the ship from the bridge. This is the bridge. It's two long console tables with a nice view. You can stand there. There's no chairs so that the people on watch don't fall asleep. It makes a very convenient standing desk. And so when you're out at sea, there's an officer on watch. The officers take turns. They have shifts. Each officer has a four-hour shift twice a day. So the first officer is midday till 4 p.m. and midnight till 4 a.m., and then they rotate. During the day, there's only one person who has to be on duty, keeping an eye out. The ship's pretty autonomous. It kind of runs itself, more or less. And at night, when it gets dark, you switch to night mode, which is basically you turn all the lights and LEDs into a darker mode, and you cover up anything that hasn't got a dark mode, and you switch the screens to inverse colors. But you also get a bit of help. You usually have an AB or a junior officer who also keeps watch and helps you spot things in the dark. You can only really see forwards. There's no rear view mirror. Behind you, the containers are stacked higher than the bridge. There is a small window that lets you look backwards, but this is the view. To help you navigate, you've got different instruments. You've got your radar, which shows you other ships. It lets you do handy things, like you can click on another object, and it will tell you how far away it is, which course it's going on, and whether you're likely to collide with it. You've also got the ECTIS, which is an electronic chart, which has the AIS information showing where all the ships around you are. And these are just, well, at one point I was talking to the captain at night, and I was asking, and because he'd worked for so long before GPS, they used sextant still, and I was like, oh, do you still use those? And he was like, yeah, we've got a few on board. Here, I'll show you. And he went to open the cupboard. The cupboard was labeled Voyage Charts. He opened it, and there was just two Windows computers in there running the charts. We did find the sextant and use it in the end, but he admitted that if they ever ran into trouble where the computers broke, he would just get his iPhone and use that instead. You've got the echo sounder to know the depth beneath you, in case you forget the depth beneath what? It's a boat. Everything has lower tech backups. Any new technology installed doesn't replace things. He just kind of layers on top, so the echo sounder also has an analog printout. There's different ways of steering the ship. It's usually under autopilot, which follows waypoints. And it's literally just lat long points that the ship kind of guides itself between.
and it sets the speed of the ship to match its arrival time at the next port, so it knows which speed to go at.
And to create your own waypoints, you just kind of point and click,
and it warns you if you're running into any obstacles, in this case, plowing into a harbour wall. And they're all synced, so there's two backups on both sides of the ship. And it warns you when things go a bit wrong, like you've drifted off course. This was one night when the autopilot suddenly veered us off to one side for no discernible reason. In which cases, you can just take the wheel, steering wheel, turn left, turn right. In cases where the steering fails, you can take over manually. At the back of the ship is the steering gear room. This is all the equipment that physically pushes the rudder back and forth. And you can go down there, manually control the rudder's position, and just phone up to the bridge to find out which way to steer. Other important feature of the bridge, tea and coffee making facilities. My two favorite buttons, the sea mode button, which you press when you're at sea, and the main buzzer stop, which turns off all the alarms. There's quite a lot of alarms. They go off for things like dead man's handles, distress signals from other ships, just all sorts of things. Each cabin has an alarm box, which tells you when something is going wrong on the ship, and it knows who's on duty, so it only wakes up the right people. And one night, I was trying to get to sleep, and I could hear the alarm going off in the room next door. I was next door to the second engineer, so I was like, ooh, let's go have a look at this. And I looked at the box, and it said, main engine system control failure. I thought, this sounds like a good one. So I went outside, and he's kind of stood there, kind of like, oh, God, here goes. So I got to the bridge, and we're in pitch black. On the horizon, there's lightning storms on either side, and our engine has failed, and we are steering out of the shipping lane. I thought, ooh, this is nice. Well, spooky, but nice. And so the next morning, I got up and talked to the captain at the breakfast table and said, oof, I heard the alarms last night. And he kind of went, oh, yes, major disaster last night. And I said, yeah, main engine failure, that seems serious. So I was like, oh, no, that happens all the time. So I was like, what major disaster were you on about? And he went, the email went down. The email? Yeah, we do everything by email. Everything you need to know, everything you communicate is email. You kind of know which berth you're going to, which port you're going to. It's all just email. So it turns out the engine was just a faulty sensor and there was nothing wrong. Yeah, you've got things for reading distress messages. You've got the radio room at the back, which has all your radio equipment, like Inmarsat receivers, which still use floppy disks to take their settings and updates, which have the most amazing screensavers, which slowly form the Inmarsat main. A lot of the stuff's automated, so you have the ship's server that runs everything. You've got a computer on the bridge, so you can answer email whilst you're navigating, which is called the Seagull. Since everything runs on software, it's all very secure. And so because of the typhoon, we'd been delayed a bit. We were running a few days late, and we just received an email one day saying, you're no longer going to Hong Kong, we're sending you to Yantian instead. And you just do what the ship's told. The operations choose where you go when. If the ship's going at the wrong speed for fuel efficiency, sometimes they'll just phone you up and complain. Everything has an analog backup on the ship, so they still take paper logs. Officially, you navigate from paper charts, not from the computers are just to aid you. When you receive updates for the charts, they are literally patches that you stick on the chart. You've got a black box recorder, which records the conversations on the bridge, as well as the data, which I didn't know until the end. So all of the stupid questions I've asked are recorded somewhere, and there's a backup hard drive on the roof that floats off if you sink. You've got sextants and azimuth circles, backup systems for navigating with. You've also got your flag cupboard. It's a cupboard full of flags. It's got flags for all the countries you might end up at and flags for communicating with. Things for like, I've got a pilot on board, I need a tug, I'm on fire. So this is the normal setup when we go into port. Red is carrying dangerous cargo, yellow is haven't passed quarantine yet. We also have like an old barometer for finding out the weather on the bridge, which is someone's secret cigarette store. We never found out who the secret smoker is. Anyway, and our next port of call was Kaohsiung. Kaohsiung is a port in Taiwan. Pretty much every port we stopped at was within the top 10 busiest ports in the world. Kaohsiung also has a narrow entrance. It's probably the most difficult port to go into that we went into. So we arrived, the pilot came aboard and immediately started shouting lots of things into the radio, which we didn't understand. And he kind of explained that he had to coordinate carefully our arrival so that the other ships and us could go through the narrow opening of the harbour without colliding. So that's the narrow opening of the harbour. I didn't see any of this. I was downstairs in the engine room. This is our tug. And that's how you turn. The tug just pushes you around. The ship straight ahead is coming out of our berth just about 60 seconds before we go into it. Kaohsiung is also where we had our first shore leave. We had 3 hours to run ashore and do land things. Basically, you get to the port entrance, and there's a taxi driver who kind of knows you're a sailor. You need the complete sailor package. You need shampoo, clothes, beer, food. And in 3 hours, he will drive you to all these places, do all these things, exchange money into a local currency for you. He's just like a full-stack integrated service. So this is the brief glimpse of the outside world. He takes us to the place that provides all these things. It's just a supermarket and an IKEA. You kind of think, oh, we're going abroad, we're going to exotic new places, and no, you just see the same thing you would see at home. Anyway, so arriving at Kaohsiung, I didn't get to see any of this view. I was down in the engineering control room. This is where they control everything engineering related. And it has no windows. There's no CCTV system. You can't see the outside world. I was chatting to the second engineer, and he said, the only time I see the sea is when it leaks in through a pipe. This is Chief Engineer Oleg's pen. Do not steal Chief Engineer Oleg's pen. And it's just like any engineering workshop environment. You know, it's got all the little slogans, passive-aggressive signs, Argos catalogue, biscuits. The main engine room itself is incredibly hot. When we were there, it was going about 40 degrees. When you're in there, you have to come out frequently to pick up water. You take salt tablets twice a day to make up for the amount of salt you lose if you sweat. So the chief engineer took us on a bit of a tour. It's deafeningly loud. We have no idea what he said to us. All we know is he pointed at things. This is the engine. We only had one main engine. There's no backup if anything goes wrong. It's quite big. It's about 3 stories tall. That's one floor of it. That's another floor of it. And it's connected to the propeller shaft, which drives the propeller. And to get into this, you've got like a sealed sliding door to slide through. Engineering things. All the spare parts you'd need to fix the ship are kept on the ship, because you can't just call the AA. So just randomly weld into spots around the ship, there's all the spare parts you need. These are spare pistons for the engine. And also, because you might be swaying, you can't use step ladders. So there's ladders welded in everywhere you might need them. It's a bit like a Microsoft screensaver with all the pipes. And we literally went everywhere. We went into every little nook and cranny, down little hatches into the bow for us, to all these compartments where they have to pump in extra oxygen when you're in there so that you can breathe. Anyway. So eventually we arrived at Yantian, our final port of call where we would leave. It's where we were stopping instead of Hong Kong. It's literally next to the Hong Kong border. So much so that this dotted line is the border. The quay runs up to the border. You'll notice here there aren't any ships berthed there because they would straddle the border. The only complication with this was Yantian is in China. Hong Kong is sort of not. For Hong Kong, you don't need a Chinese visa. You can just turn up as a British person. China, you need a visa. Before I got on the flight to get there, my visa application was denied for China. Luckily, our port agent kindly found a loophole in the Chinese immigration law that they introduced a year ago, which allows seafarers to go to the nearest airport without a visa. And basically, they give you a piece of paper with a stamp on it. And you go to the border to Hong Kong, and you hand over the piece of paper with a stamp on it, and they look at you. And they press a button, and the supervisor turns up. And you get put in a room because they think you're here without a visa, and that you're trying to sneak through a piece of paper you printed yourself. And it turns out nobody in this port that I'd gone through, this immigration checkpoint I'd gone through, had ever seen this type of visa. And it took quite a few hours to clear up. So that's it for the ship. The expedition was also intended to explore supply chains, factories and refineries in China. So we went to Yiwu, which is so new that it's not on the satellite imagery or OpenStreetMaps yet. It's a vast wholesale assisted city which has all the commodities full of showrooms for different factories. It's vast. Each bit of this shopping center is an entire district of the city. And each of the districts is split into floors and sections which specialize in different things. Cosmetics, zips, belts, fabric, socks. There was about 100 sock shops there. And it's just vast. I caught the bus from one end to the other and it took an hour. And I walked from one end to the other and it took from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. And it's got everything. So there's a section for inflatable toys, which is full of inflatable toys. There's shops specializing in eyes to put on toys. Plastic, pink injection molded plastic, aisles full of it. Toothbrushes, cereal, washi tape, umbrellas. Souvenirs to sell in shops to London, tourists to London, are all made here and shipped over. Footballs, flags, vuvuzelas, another vuvuzela dealer. Just everything, everything, just everything that you might ever not need, and it's all junk. Anyway, and in Yiwu, it was just the end of Christmas season. They were tearing down the Christmas shops. They were just finishing selling the Christmas products. So the wholesalers come over, they buy Christmas products, they get made in the local factories, they get shipped. So we went to Yiwu port, which is odd because Yiwu is inland. It's a few hours away from Shanghai and it doesn't have an ocean. It doesn't have a seaport. What they do is they box up the stuff here, ready to go into containers. They pass customs here. The container is sealed with a special label and it's driven 100 miles to the sea. And so the inside of the metal box is outside of China, has left the country. The metal box itself is still in China, which I can't get my head around. So they were loading up just Christmas lights here, just endless Christmas stuff. And we even went to a Christmas factory, which has every variation of Christmas theme you might ever need. Just tiny variations on our theme, just endless Christmas stuff. These are Christmas hats made for UK4U, which is the charity which sends a Christmas hat to every soldier in the British Army. These are going to Afghanistan next. We also had a chance to visit Batao, which is where all the rare earth metals for mobile phones and electronics are made. And it's just vast, full of iron factories. This is a tailings pond. This is all toxic waste runoff from the process. Just endless spouting, just piles of stuff. And run out of time. These are rare earths. This is a magnet factory we went to. These are magnets being made. We're in one of the factories, and the person giving us a tour said, our CEO wants to give you a lunch. And we thought, oh, good, we'll go to the canteen, you'll give us some sandwiches and have an awkward conversation. No, he booked a room at the Rare Earth International Hotel, the tallest building in Batao, and laid on entertainment for Mongolia's top singers. And just got us very drunk and led us on in wrestling contests, gave us rice wine, which is apparently 300 British pounds a bottle and can only be bought through government officials. And he got us incredibly drunk, and we left at 1 p.m. and had to go visit his rival's factory. And I've ran over, so I'm just going to leave it there. Thank you.